Tim Richmond came in 1978 to try to work on the high-resolution structure, to try to get better crystals. And we had got better crystals by this time, thanks to Len Lutter's work. And they diffracted to quite high resolutions, about 6 or 7 angstroms at the time. And with Tim Richmond, we solved the structure to 7 angstrom resolution, wasn't it? Yes. In which you could see the DNA very clearly, the two turns of the DNA on it. And you could identify the different domains. You could see alpha helices just on the edge of alpha. You could see the alpha helices of H3 straddling the dymer position on the DNA and so on. It was really rather. And so that was the nucleosome. But Tim Richmond went off to Zurich. There was a hiatus in all this because a man called Moudrianakis, working at Johns Hopkins, questioned and said it was all wrong, it was all rubbish, because he had solved the structure of a histone octamer, he thought, and found that it was much bigger than the histone octamer we had put into our model. And this, apart from anything else, almost it was published in Science, no less. It was done by a single heavy atom. It was also done by what do you call solution averaging around? There's a word for it. X-ray crystallography. You take out a shape. You use it to carve out a shape. It's the man who worked it out. What is his name? Anyway, it was a standard technique, and they claimed to have done it, solvent flattening. And this is meant to be X-ray crystallography. One of the referees of that paper late was Alex Rich and so on. This was published in Science. So our paper was regarded as wrong, and the model was regarded as wrong. And Alex Rich enjoyed a certain bit of schadenfreude. As you know, because he'd been beaten on the tRNA, enjoyed that. He told me he refereed it. He said, well, you have to settle all this. But of course, the whole thing was rubbish because they'd done everything wrongly. Their heavy atom was on a twofold axis of symmetry, but they hadn't realized it, and solvent flattening. And it almost cost Tim Richmond his job. By this time, he was going to move to Zurich, where the head of the ETH at Zurich, you know, the Federal Institute of Technology, was a friend of Moudrianakis, and said this chap was unreliable. But luckily, I interceded and said, Moudrianakis is wrong, totally wrong, and we can demonstrate that. And it turned out in the end, it was all solved by a chap at Pittsburgh, whose name I've forgotten, but he was one of those who introduced solvent flattening. And so our nucleosome structure was right at that level. But it was quite one of those episodes. It shows that you actually need, well, we had a perfectly good high resolution structure, but it was the, we didn't have heavy atoms at the time, did we? No. So that was the nucleosome structure. And also the higher order structure, which was the string of nucleosomes.
But Tim went on to do the
higher. Tim went on, yes. So Tim, this was done. This was done by random DNA extracted from chromatin. So 147 base pairs was 147 plus or minus 2 or so. We couldn't control the exact length of the DNA. And we could see that in the crystal structure, 7 angstroms, the ends of the DNA of 2 different nucleosomes came together like this. So clearly it was dependent upon the length, exact crystal. And we did shrink the crystals and so on to try to get them packed tightly. So what Tim did after he went to Zurich was to use defined length DNA of defined length, absolutely fixed length. And he used 146 and 147. And he crystallized it using exactly our crystallization conditions. And he solved the structure. He could do it by isomorph replacement because we had the 7 angstrom structure. And he did that. I'm not sure he used heavy atoms at all. And by that time also, by that time, the people had introduced fast freezing, so you could preserve structures to higher resolution. And the days that so they absolutely well, it was important. He made a dimeric. And he made a dimeric, but there are two ways you can make DNA, a DNA sequence dimeric with twofold symmetry. That was important. You see, if you have a twofold axis perpendicular to the DNA, there are twofold axes in the plane of the bases, and there's another twofold axis between the bases. So therefore, he could make, so that's why he made 146 and 147, which would mean that the twofold symmetry would be in two different positions. So one would be totally symmetrical, the other case would be twisted to one side. He solved them both. And so eventually this led to a high resolution structure of the nucleosome. That was ultimately published in about the early 90s, I think. It took quite a few years, 1900. So it was quite an achievement. But it's all based upon the basically, everyone, Kornberg's biochemistry and now crystallography, the foundations for that.